All right. Hey, thanks for coming by. I'm Bradley Takahashi, your host for Community Corner. And for this session, we're pretty fortunate to have a couple of women who are very active in the Columbia HSA,
Home and School Association.
Man, Home and School Association. You can tell I've really done my homework on this. And I've been a member of HSA for many, many years. So let me welcome Sandra Kerriam and Sharon Rorty. And they're here to talk to us today about the HSA in general, specifically also the series of roundtables that you guys are instrumental in running. And maybe you can tell us a little bit about, you know, those things and some of the other aspects that the HSA does.
Thank you, Brad. Thank you for having us on the show. I am Sandra Kerriam. I am the co-president of the HSA this year, along with Andrea Johnson. And we are trying this year to be just much more active and proactive in the community. As you mentioned, we held a roundtable in November where we dealt with the subject of the climate at Columbia. We felt that there was a need to get the parents and the teachers and the administrators and the students together to talk about, you know, how we can make Columbia a better place to be for everyone. And so we had our first roundtable where we had lots of parents come out, and we thought it was very productive. We initiated a dialogue to talk about some of the concerns, and we have actually followed up with some subcommittees that are continuing to work on some of these subject matters, such as the school spirit at Columbia, safety and security at Columbia, and how we can improve communication between the home and the school.
Well, you know, when you say a round table, what does that concept actually mean? I do picture something like a round table, but you're talking about like a big community meeting or something? Like, where did you have that first one?
The first one was pretty much a big community meeting. We had it in the new cafeteria.
Okay.
And we had a panel of administrators and teachers and students at the front of the room, basically, or the back of the room, at a long table. It wasn't a round table this time. We had lots of folks in the audience, and then we had a moderator who posed specific questions to the members of the panel and took questions from the audience, and we sort of just, you know, went back and forth.
And was there a lot of give and take between the audience and the panel?
There was some. The audience asked questions, the panel members responded.
And you didn't have to check the audience for weapons or anything like that. It was a pretty friendly thing.
You know what? I thought everyone was very civil, that the moderator did a terrific job in keeping the program moving and in getting to everyone so that they had a chance to say what they had to say. This was really an opportunity to hear from the students. We don't often get that opportunity. It was an opportunity to hear directly from the administrators as well and from the teachers. And so I think this is something that the community really appreciated and would like to see more of.
Now, when you say see more of, do you have any more planned for this coming school year?
Actually, we do. We have one coming up that will deal with the subject of academic excellence. And since Sharon is spearheading that, I'm going to have her talk to you about that.
Okay, thanks.
Well, in the roundtable on academic excellence, we're going to use roundtables.
We found some. But you ask the guys in shop. Oh, they don't have that anymore.
Yeah, no. That we're bringing the roundtable back. This is going to be. We're going to start with a large discussion. We have a three-part program, and the large discussion is questions and responses. To the same kind of people that were at our long table the last time. The Board of Ed members, principal, school administrators, students, teachers, but we're going to kind of spread them out around the room, a table, sitting with students and parents, and mix everyone around. It's a little less formal, and talk about academic excellence. What are some people's goals? What are their expectations? What's the criteria? How do we define academic excellence? And, you know, there's plenty of standards out there too, but what are our expectations? How do we define it? What do we think?
How do you recruit the people that participate, the students, the parents? Did you say Board of Ed members as well?
Yes.
So, like, for the example of students, I see about 50 out there. How do you find them? People who didn't leave class early enough at the end of the day, or what are they?
No, we really find that they're pretty anxious to participate, and we, in fact, found in the first roundtable discussion that the students were anxious and happy, really, to be invited, to be given a chance to speak, to have input. So that's not a problem. We went out to the student council.
Right. We went to the student council. We went to the club council, the various organizations, and we asked them to select someone or a couple of students to participate, and we had no trouble getting the students to come out.
I'm guessing if the dialogue in our house was an indication, you probably had a lot of students who wanted to say, to set the record straight almost, right? That I'll bet you there's a perception that so many of the grown-ups, no matter what topic you choose about the high school, grown-ups, especially people who aren't parents, think one thing about the school, and the kids will think something totally different. So that's probably, did that kind of bear that out?
It was interesting to hear what the students had to say. I mean, they wanted to clarify some things about the school. They wanted to tell us what was going on as opposed to what our perceptions were. And they were very clear that it was important to them for us to listen to them. And, you know, it was amazing to hear the students get up, get in front of us and basically say, this is what's going on at Columbia. This is how we need you to work with us to make sure that it's a better place for all of us. And so they were quite anxious to do that.
And do you think any of that input was, how's that being processed by the grown-ups in charge? I mean, two things. One is, what continuing things you said are going on as a result of that first round table, the one that's coming up, are there opportunities for students or parents or people out in the community to continue working and working on some of these issues that come up?
Yeah, there are. There's committees that came out of the first round table, and there's students that signed up to be on mm-hmm. those committees. Mm-hmm. So they will continue to meet. And each of the committees, because we did that program, we had three different areas that we looked at. They had issues. We wrote them down, and they're in a sense checklist, but it's bigger than a checklist. But they'll continue to work through those issues, and on our website, we post any results, what some of the concerns were, and as they work them through, it's still too early, but we do post results.
We will go ahead and post your website for mm-hmm. people who can, so people can check in to see what's available there. Also, is that a way for parents, students, or a community at large to, how do they get in touch with you guys or the HSA and say, I want to help out, you know, I've got something, I think I have something to contribute about the school atmosphere.
That's an excellent place to start. The website has copies of all the newsletters put out by the HSA, going back at least a year. And each newsletter has an article from the co-presidents talking about what has gone on for the previous month, for example, and what things are planned. And we invite parents to attend our monthly meeting, executive board meeting. We invite parents to sign up for committees. We provide information to the parents. Whatever handouts may have been given out in school, we have posted on the website. We have dates of meetings. So there's a lot of information to be found on our website. And we encourage parents to take a look and visit it from time to time.
Okay. And what about input from non-parents, grown-ups in the community? Does that ever happen? You know, there's probably a lot of people here who don't have kids, and they probably gripe about the taxes more so than parents because they're getting nothing, you know, out of it, presumably. I don't know. So how about that? Do you get any input from that segment of the population?
We are inviting. The roundtables are open to the community. Mm-hmm. In fact, this one, coming on the show is part of it, to let people know that we're having this roundtable and it's not just limited to parents and
what's
students.
What's the date of that one?
March 22nd.
And that's what day of the week is that?
A Wednesday.
And it's in the evening.
At right. 7 p.m.
At the high school?
At the high school, school
yes. In fact, we're really encouraging too, you know, so members of the community, we're going to be inviting the governing councils, as we did in the first one.
Governing yeah. councils of
from the town.
Oh, those guys. Oh, yeah. Right. Yes. Right. Did yes. they, how, what was the attendance from the governing councils like?
You know, I'm not sure. They may have been in the audience. They were not invited to be part of the panel, uh-huh. but they might have been in the audience.
Oh, they didn't get to stand up and make a speech. Maybe they, yeah.
Well, you know, this was for the kids. This yeah, was really for the students, to give them an opportunity to let us know what their concerns were, yeah. what they wanted to tell us about what was going on at Columbia, what they were proud of, what they were not so proud of, what they'd like to see change. Yeah. So it was their opportunity to really talk to the parents and the teachers and
well,
the administrators.
Was there anything that you took away from the kids that really surprised you or changed, or was at odds with your prior perception, you know, in any area? Was there anything that hit you or maybe some of the other grown-ups like, whoa, I didn't think of it that way?
Well, you know, the kids had some concerns, and we thought some of those concerns were legitimate concerns as to their ability to express their school pride, for instance. Mm-hmm. You know, this year the kids have not had the opportunity to have pep rallies, for instance. And that was something that some of them felt very strongly about, that they wanted this opportunity to have pep rallies. And so they said to us, you know, you have to trust us. We're trying to make this a safe event. So how can we work together to reinstate that privilege, basically?
That's something that, that's a change in the last couple of years?
Yeah, yes. Oh. There were some safety concerns, and so, you know.
What do you think the early returns are on that? Is the administration thinking about it, or?
The administration is thinking about it. There's a committee working specifically on that, and we hope to have at least one pep rally before the end of the school year.
Yeah, that'd be good.
They're looking at different alternatives for pep rallies. How do other schools do it? How can we include the whole school?
Yeah.
So they're looking at different formats, and they'll bring them back to the administration, and hopefully they'll consider it. Mm-hmm. And it was just really important for the students to feel that they were heard, and not just heard and left there.
Yeah.
That we'll continue to work on it.
And so you mentioned the HSA newsletters. I'm wondering, if I were a kid, how do I know that our concerns were landing somewhere? I mean, what's the vehicle for, like, I mean, you don't use the HSA to sort of saying, this is what, because I've seen some of those. I read them, and I don't think I saw like a whole like follow up on what the roundtable was and, you know, what the committees are doing or whatnot. Is there a way for?
There actually was some follow up in the newsletters. There was an article written by the co-presidents where we summarized what happened and what the action plan was, and that there were these smaller groups working on separate issues, and we posted some of that information on the website itself as to what these groups were doing and how parents can get involved. So we do we did try to follow up with the parents through the newsletter as well as the website.
Yeah. Okay. All right. And do you have? I mean, you're not giving anything away by revealing who's going to be some of the people on the panel coming up in this next roundtable.
No, it will be the same. We'll be inviting members from the Board of Ed, again, school principal. She's the co-sponsor.
Uh-huh.
Members of her staff, teachers. One of the things, we really want to reach into the eighth grade, because part of what we're doing is looking at the school. We want to look at it 5 years. So when with the current eighth grade, when they graduate, what should Columbia look like? It is about academic.
I've seen those eighth graders. That's scary. No, I'm kidding.
I have one of those scary eighth graders.
Right.
But we really want to look at it today. You know, what do we want it to be tomorrow? What do we want it to be 3 years from now? And what about in the year 2011? What should Columbia High School look like? So we really want the eighth grade parents and students to come too. We want to include them. That's part of it. And the second part of the program will be, we'll actually use the round tables. We're going to go into a discussion, a visioning exercise. What's good, what's working, what are some of the things we'd want to bring in, some of the improvements we want to make, and what are the successes we want to highlight that aren't getting out there. So we'll have a visioning exercise. And the third part is to then for the tables to report out and talk about it and see where there's overlap, where there's consensus on needs and goals. And what do we want to do going from there? So we don't just leave it that night.
Okay. Important question. Do you guys have refreshments of these things?
You know, the first one we did not.
You know, we're going to have to stop on that because I can't take that. We're going to take a little break here. We'll be back in about a minute. But, okay, thanks.
It is about balancing our choices between the gray of the concrete jungle and the stunning beauty of the real one. Between a stoic facade of granite and the fury of the canyon. Between deafness and the presence of breathtaking music. Between blindness and blinding beauty. Why there's EarthShare, the simple way to find balance. EarthShare is the workplace giving program bringing the leading environmental groups under one umbrella. Support EarthShare, support them all. EarthShare. Please ask your employer about workplace giving. To learn more, please visit our website.
Announcement. Okay. Okay, thanks. We're back again. I'm Bradley Takahashi with Community Corner with my guests Sandra Karim and Sharon Rorty, who, you know, much to my embarrassment, I always thought I knew what HSA stood for. That was Home Students Association, but there's no students in there. So
well, you know, students are at the school.
They're at the school. Yeah. School, okay, all right. And let me ask you, how did it become HSA when, you know, when I was growing up, it was PTA? You know, what parents and teachers, that became like an old concept or what?
Well, the PTAs are traditionally they're PTAs in the elementary school. At the high school, we choose not to be a PTA so that we don't have to abide by the national rules of the national PTA organization. We don't have to pay their dues. We don't have to abide by those rules. And that is why we call ourselves the Home and School Association.
You mean, are there some high schools that are PTAs?
Though? Absolutely.
Yeah, because I think my high school had a PTA. Yep. Yep. Oh, but so you're doing it as a cost-cutting measure. I mean, so
that's one way to look at it, Bradley.
So there is no national HSA group
No. This is where we don't have the rules and regulations. We're sort of more loose. We're looser in
I wonder if our town can do that with respect to the county. You know what? Okay. So that's why HSA. So I don't feel so guilty that I don't know what HSA stands for. Okay. Homeschool Association. But I know it doesn't cost that much to join. I mean, the dues are like $10 or something like that.
The
right?
dues are very reasonable. Is it 10 or 20?
It's 20.
Is it 20? You know.
But that's for an entire family. So if you have several kids at the school, you still only pay the same amount, the $20.
Now, my family's shrinking. Is it still 20?
Yes. It's still 20.
All right. Okay. Well, that's okay.
But we do encourage parents to join the HSA.
And teachers as well.
And teachers and administrators. It's such an important vehicle for us to keep communication between the home and the school, for parents to find out what's going on, for parents and teachers and students to work together in a partnership to basically, you know, get the best for our kids. That's what this is all about. And this year, I think we have a terrific board, executive board running the HSA this year. A group of women who are very dedicated, who have a lot of energy, and who are go-getters. And we're trying to put together...
You said a group of women, so there's no guys on there?
No guys. We're open, though. We'd love to have some guys on there.
You mentioned energy and go-getting, and that knocks out most guys. I know that.
That might be the problem.
But, you know, the group, we've done so much this year in terms of improving communication. We are in the process of putting in place this software called Edline, which will allow parents to have access to information about their kids at the school, what classes they're taking, if they've been late, if they've been absent.
Yeah, so they don't have to call Mrs. Helmstead.
You don't have to call anymore.
Mm-hmm. And the students have that same access.
Students have access too.
Assignments. Yeah. Homework assignments.
Well, I know some teachers take advantage of. They set up their own little, you know.
Yes. Yes.
That would be great.
But this would be for the entire school, and you know, we're hoping to have all the teachers. Basically.
Is our technical crew back there picking this up? I mean, that's going to be more work for them. Edline. So. You mentioned some constituencies in the school, and it's true. Everybody agrees everything should be here, all with a common goal of making the most fruitful experience for the kids, right? You got the teachers, you got the administrators, you got the parents. Did I miss anybody? And yet, how do you feel, I mean, as your role as the HSA, I mean, sometimes, like right now, the teachers haven't been with a contract or whatnot. I mean, does that ever put you guys in a awkward position? I mean, you know, making the teachers and the students and the administration all work together. I mean, are those issues that you're grappling with?
There are certainly issues that they are issues that we grapple with from time to time. However, we see our role basically as we're neutral. We're not here to necessarily take a position on anything on any of these issues. We are here to facilitate, to make sure that the parties are talking to each other, to make sure that the parties have a common goal, and so. We find that, you know, we're supportive of the teachers, and we want the best contract for them. We also want what's best for the school and the district in general, so that we encourage the parties to talk to each other and reach, and we hope that they'll reach a contract very soon.
It's the Board of Ed does policy.
We don't do policy.
Although, I mean, sometimes we want to do policy, but we really don't. We know where the line is, and I think that's really important.
I see. I was just hoping maybe you guys had the key somehow
to get this done.
Yeah, sometimes sometimes you think, do they realize we're all on the same side on all this? You know.
Well, we hope so, and we hope that the students is ultimately what the focus is.
Right. Yeah. We hope no one loses sight of that fact that we really have the common goal.
I mean, I agree with you, but most students, I've seen a couple of my friends of my kids, and I think, I don't know, about those guys. But no, about the parental involvement. Mm-hmm. You know, there's always, I think when I was going to school, it was always the same. You'd see the same parents, you know, at the PTA stuff. Mm-hmm. And sometimes that's a good thing, sometimes that's not a good mm-hmm. thing. I mean, it's almost like some parents will think, oh, that's just what the HSA does. I mean, what can you do? I'm assuming that there's probably more parents that could get involved than they're not. And in fact, the more that do, the stronger you're going to be, you know, that you get to have everybody's constituency sort of spoken for. I mean, what can you guys do to sort of like get more parents involved?
That is definitely a concern of ours, and we're trying to brainstorm and come up with ways to improve parental participation.
See, I think if you had a keg at your next meeting, I think I'd be there. You know,
well, some of the grade reps, I'm a sophomore grade rep, but the junior grade reps have been very proactive in that area. They've set up really networks, small networks mm-hmm. of parents mm-hmm. That can meet at different parents' homes, like groups of 10 or less than 10, so that they get to know each other and can share their concerns, issues, help each other out in a smaller network way. And the rest of us are watching and hoping and seeing how that works, and then may pick that up as something that we can emulate throughout the grades.
And we're also trying to do simple things like offer transportation to some of our events. Mm. At the last, was it the round table, where we actually had a jitney service set up.
You advertise this on the web? Or
we had it on the web. We sent in the newsletter. I believe we had, we contacted the parental, what do you call them, Sharon?
The liaisons to the middle school.
Right.
Yes. So we're trying so that if someone doesn't have transportation, mm-hmm. They can get on the jitney. We had the one in Maplewood picks up people at the pool. Because that's pretty far distance out.
Oh,
yeah, the Maplewood Pool.
Down there, right.
Mm-hmm. If you live that far out and you don't have a car, a second car, you know, access to private transportation, you can get on the jitney, and that will take you here. And in South Orange, the other jitney was picking up at Marshall Elementary School and bringing folks in. And we'll continue to do that at the big meetings, not for every meeting, but for the big meetings, we'll continue to pick parents up and bring them in so that we can get more people here.
Because we do believe it's very important to get more involvement from a cross-section of the population, and that's what one of the primary things that we are working on this year.
Yeah, it's tough because you see it's almost a parallel of, you know, when you're going to school, it's not like every kid gets involved in student council, for example.
Right.
You know, in fact, some guys would say, I don't want anything to do with that, you know. And I think it probably carries over when you're grown up, or maybe not a grown up, you're older. And you probably think, it's the same kids that were in student council now and they're HSA. But you're right, the guys that don't take part, they sort of then, their voice is never heard.
Never heard. Mm-hmm.
And
right.
Then not only that, when your voice isn't heard, people who aren't who are there assume the worst about you, you know? Oh, they're not here, they don't care, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
right.
I don't know how you get that message across, but I know it's tough.
It continues to be a challenge, but we're working on it.
I really think that refreshments are
we do provide refreshments.
You know, Monday night
sometimes.
Football, yeah, that's when there's an HSA thing.
I think we'll have to have refreshments at the next
round. Yeah, we'll revisit that.
Okay. So what happens, it seems to me the whole HSA thing, it's got like an unlimited charter. You can get as active and as imaginative as the people themselves want or care to be. How many different committees are there, like at any given moment, and what are the opportunities for people to volunteer? Right now, you say get on a website, but I know if I'm mm-hmm. a parent out there, maybe can you tick off some of the various areas that you're looking for help? You know, what kind of expertise or who's got time? Some people work, you know, mm-hmm. all day and say, I don't have time to do this, but what can you identify some ways that people can only devote like a couple hours a month can help
sure.
out?
At the beginning of the school year, we actually sent a form home asking parents to volunteer for certain events. We had specific events such as, you know, we had an eighth grade parent night that the HSA was, you know, helped the school to host. We asked parents to work on the Midnight Madness Committee, which is for the seniors graduating. We asked parents to work on these round tables with us. We sometimes host a tea or a brunch for the faculty. And so, you know, even parents can actually bring a dish for something like that, or turn up for a couple of hours to help clean up and set up and things like that. So there are lots of opportunities.
We have an outdoor beautification committee, and come springtime, some think they'll be busy on the weekends or after school or something, but, you know, you come, you bring a shovel, you'll do weeding, you know, there's some people that really are very handy at landscaping, and other people are just there, you know.
You can make it like a picnic, too.
And a lot of people like to come to that kind of thing. They know it's just a Saturday. They're going to, you know, roll up their sleeves and get busy, get a little dirty, but feel that they've accomplished something at the end of the day. And we look for volunteers for that kind of thing.
And speaking of beautification, members of the HSA board actually renovated and decorated room A107. They painted it.
That's
for the teachers.
Oh, that yes. One in the corner?
Yes.
The one in the corner.
The meeting room. I think some of the student groups.
New curtains, new wallpaper and painting.
Yeah, because those teachers make a mess of that room. Right?
It's gorgeous now. You should see it. That's some of our handiwork. Uh-huh. So we get involved in lots of different things.
Okay. All right. How about some of those, like, back-to-school nights or college kind of things? Is that you guys, too, or... I know there's a couple different groups mm-hmm. that do these sorts of things.
The administrator and the guidance department and the teachers generally put together their own programs for those affairs. But they do ask us to sometimes provide refreshments. They ask reps from the board to say a few words to welcome the parents and talk about the HSA. So we get involved in that respect.
So if somebody wants to help, I know I've gone to your website. It's not like you can email your questions there. Where can somebody actually... short of calling up, because somebody might be, you know, afraid to call up. They've seen you on television. Hi, Miss Kareem. How can they sort of anonymously email you or say, look, I'm interested in helping. Here's my name. How do you know that?
The newsletter has names, contact information.
Okay.
And so the parents are welcome to reach out to the co-presidents, to the grade reps.
You know what? You got to change those. Title. See, I'm always nervous calling up somebody who's got president in their title, you know.
Well, then you can call a grade rep. We get calls as a grade rep. I'll get calls from parents that I've never heard of, and it's fine. And they'll say, you know, I can't find this information. Can mm-hmm. you tell me where to find it? And if I can't, then I can call Sandy or Andrea or someone else. There's also, you'll have all the contact information for the other committees. It's all listed right there in the newsletter.
Okay. All right.
That newsletter is kind of like the Bible.
I guess it is. And I mean, I do get it. Do I get it in the mail, or does my kid bring it?
I guess in the mail.
I get in the mail, yeah. I've seen the co-president's thing. Anyway, that's all we have time for today. I'm sorry, I'm not sorry that way. I've had you guys here because it was pleasurable. I've learned a lot. I hope, you know, people here picked up something. And so until the next time, wait to come back and join us in Community Corner. We'll see who else shows up, okay? Thanks. All right, we're out of here.
All right. Very good. Found the key to you.